Well, I, as an environmental engineer, had worked in solid waste management, and it was actually in 2001 when I heard about our trash ending up in the ocean. I said to myself, well, we're probably doing something wrong on land, which is where I do my municipal work, for our trash to be ending up in the ocean. That's not where it's supposed to be. And so that sort of was the impetus for me trying to research how our activities in land could impact the ocean. There's lots of sources. There's both maritime and land-based sources, but like I said, I focus sort of on this land-based source, and it's really our everyday activities, the waste that we generate every day when we decide to get a cup of coffee or a packaged food item. That is the kind of waste that I'm talking about that can end up in our ocean if we don't manage it properly. I think when we got to the final number, and not just that number, the 8 million metric tons, but trying to visualize that number. So what I did was turn that into a volume that you can imagine. So if we all stand hand to hand covering the coastline of the world, we would each have in front of us 5 grocery size bags filled with plastic. And that's what we estimate is going in every year. And when you really sit and think about that covering the whole coastline of the world, it's significant. So I would say, instead of picking a single polymer, I think, you know, we talked about some of those packaging items and the single-use items, and that's what we tend to find in the litter, in the marine litter environment. And so the consequence is, you know, you have impacts to animals interacting, ingestion, entanglement, and you know, and we're not sure actually even about human health and potential impacts to the food web and the ecosystem that we participate in as well. So, well, I don't study that specifically, but, you know, I think what we're starting to see is that really the plastic, when it breaks down into these smaller and smaller particles called microplastic, they are ending up everywhere. So we see it in some of the food products that we're consuming, like table salt. You see it in some of the filter feeder seafood. We don't know the impacts yet on health, whether or not it has an impact, direct impact on us. But we are really kind of seeing it everywhere. So it's sort of this, there's a level of concern because of that. They're a part of the debris that's found, like within our global database for marine debris tracker, but there isn't a specific impact necessarily from those other than obviously metal doesn't break down as well, but it doesn't interact necessarily with chemicals in the same way that plastic does, you know, so it has sort of a different component. It also is typically worth a lot more, so it tends to be not, you know, in the environment as much because it's so valuable. It can be collected and turned in for cash even. Bioplastic is just any plastic made with a plant material. It doesn't have to be biodegradable. You can make sort of a traditional polymer from a plant material, but you're not necessarily using a fossil fuel for some of that. The compostable plastic, which had been around a while, it was sometimes labeled biodegradable, is actually only compostable in an industrial composting system, which many of us don't have access to. And so that was a bit of an issue there because people thought it was biodegradable, but it really was only compostable. There are polymers now, though, on the cutting edge of this that are truly biodegradable. They're not on the market yet, but they will be. And I think they can be part of the solution in, a thoughtful way. It's not just the end-all, be-all. But there are going to be situations where I think this biodegradable polymer, similar to paper, can be utilized. I mean, there might be some very small niche. I mean, there's like the cassava bag in India, and there's, you know, there's a few very small market, but in terms of looking at the over 300 million metric tons of polymers that produce, the biodegradable, truly biodegradable, is, you know, a minuscule fraction of that right now. And in order for them to be expanded onto the market, they need to upscale the production. And then you'll see it in like a chip bag or something like that eventually. In the developed world, we produce a lot of waste per person. So, for example, the U.S. produces four times as much as someone in China, typically. And that's concerning. We need to reduce our waste generation in the developed world, where we have some of the luxuries of having clean tap water and being able to use reusable items and have a robust waste management system. We should be using that. In the developing world, they haven't been able to keep up the infrastructure with the economic growth that has happened so rapidly. But I think there's opportunities to sort of leapfrog the systems that we've developed here. And I just had a student presenting with an on-demand waste collection app that's happening in a community in Indonesia. And so thinking about how we can incorporate sort of cutting-edge technology, working with the informal sector, elevating them through this system, and scaling some of the culturally developed systems already that are in those contexts could be really interesting and helpful within the developing world. Probably looking at these systems that are sort of already in place where we're seeing the leakage, and if these systems are established, then sort of having to shift maybe the mindset of not only maybe citizens, but also companies and governments around the world. But I'm really optimistic because the conversation between all of those three has begun, and I think, surprisingly, even though there's a challenge, it's happening, and you see this whole shift in the conversation and with those folks communicating with each other. I think we need both ends, honestly, because the leakage is sort of is happening right now. So we need these robust waste management systems. Granted, I would love to see them turn into circular materials management systems and design waste out of these systems. And then we need to work on those upstream design changes, material substitution, and even changing, you know, sharing and collaborative economies. We need to work on those systems like yesterday, too, because those are going to take longer. So starting both of those right now, you know, I think that's great. I mean, they both need to be happening. Initially, marine debris, we were looking out in the ocean and finding plastic and finding animals interacting with that. And when we made this estimate of the actual input of plastic in the ocean, it kind of shifted the conversation to kind of upstream, going, how can we turn off this tap? What can we do upstream to stop this problem from the source? I think just sort of being aware, but if you can sort of avoid a single-use item, if you can use a reusable bottle, if you have access to clean tap water and can do that, that's one way that you can make a difference. Just managing your waste properly, trying to think about how you could develop a recycling system, maybe if there isn't one, to then add value to that plastic, because if it has value, then it's typically not going to end up littered in the environment. And then potentially doing a cleanup in some places, you know, that can not only help to keep the plastic out of the ocean, but we can collect data with that. So there's many mobile apps out there. One is Marine Debris Tracker, and if you have the data of what you're finding in the environment, then maybe you can look at upstream solutions to avoid that. Good question. I have a reusable water bottle, and I started with that one thing, and it was so much easier if you just kind of start with the one thing and get into this habit, and now my reusable water bottle is almost like a security blanket. I mean, if I don't have it, I'm like, where's my bottle? So, you know, start with that one thing. It becomes such a, you know, a habit, and then you can move on, and I still, you know, try to use reusable grocery bags. And I think the biggest thing is if you ever forget don't be too hard on yourself, because all the times that you've remembered, you've made a difference. So just because you forget once, don't be like, oh, I'm going to give up. You know, no, just it's okay if you forget that one time. At least all the other times that you've remembered, or even just that one time you can say no to the straw, you know, no to the bag, then you've made a difference.